إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله. Indeed, the most truthful of speech is the book of Allah. وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the best guidance we have is the guidance of our beloved messenger Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. وشر الأمور محدثاتها. And the worst of affairs are those things we newly invent into this religion of ours. وكل محدثة بدعة. And everything we newly invent into this religion of ours is an innovation. وكل بدعة ضلالة. And every innovation is misguidance and it leads astray. وَكُلَّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. Every misguidance, every going astray is in the hellfire. ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدِ. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind one another by preaching the Quran, this address to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and to the Ummah. Remind one another, because reminding one another profits and it benefits the believers. عن ثابت بن الحجاج قال قال عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا وزنوا أنفسكم قبل أن توزنوا فإنه أهون عليكم في الحساب غدا أن يحاسبوا أنفسكم اليوم. ثابت بن الحجاج, he narrated that عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه said, hold yourselves accountable before you are held accountable. Evaluate yourselves and check yourselves before you're evaluated and checked. For the reckoning will be easier for you tomorrow. The reckoning with Allah Azza wa Jal, it will be easier for you tomorrow if you hold yourselves accountable today. There was one of the books written by the ulama just on the adab, just on the qabr, just on the life in the grave. It's rewards for those who are righteous, it's punishments for those who were deserving of it by Allah's decree. And at the end of it, there was a chapter titled Yawm al-Islami, the Islamic Day. And this was it, and it just had a series of questions. But these questions were ones that the one who wants to please his Lord, who wants to have a safe, who wants to have a peaceful time in his or her grave, who wants to be in the safe haven under the shade of Allah, Yawm al-Qiyamah, the one who wants to make it to Jannah, then he should question himself or herself with these questions daily. And so, we want to bring this comprehensive reminder to ourselves to take each one of those questions and why, see why they're so important that we question ourselves with. The first question he asked, هل تصلي الفجر في المسجد كل يوم? The first question was, how do you pray or do you pray Salat al-Fajr in the masjid every day, in congregation? And this was the first of the questions, of all of the questions he could have asked. Because of the importance of the salah in our lives, as we've mentioned many of times. And how the Isha and the Fajr, these are the prayers that are hardest on the munafiqeen, on those who are really hypocritical with respect to their deen. عن عثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنهما قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلى العشاء في جماعة كان كقيام نصف ليلة ومن صلى العشاء والفجر في جماعة كان كقيام ليلة. Affan bin Affan narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever prays Isha prayer in congregation in the masjid, it will be written for him or her, for him, as if they wrote half the, as if they stood half the night in prayer. And the one who prays Isha and Fajr in Jama'ah in the masjid, in congregation, then it will be written for them like they stood up the whole night in prayer, even if they went home and they slept. So this was of the first of the questions that he asked. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من غدا إلى المسجد وراح أعد الله له نزله من الجنة كلما غدا أو راح رواه البخاري. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, Allah will prepare for him who goes to the masjid every morning and in the afternoon for the congregation, for the jama'ah salah in the masjid. An honorable place in paradise will be prepared for them with good hospitality for what he did every morning and every afternoon. The establishment of the salawat in the masjid, my dear brothers, and for the sisters, for you, although it's better for you to pray in your homes, to encourage your husbands, your sons, your brothers, your fathers to pray in the masajid, because this was the intent given by Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The question came, هل تحافظ على جميع الصلوات في المسجد? Have you protected and attended all of the congregational prayers at the masjid, that you do them in the house of Allah Azza wa Jal? Abdullah ibn Umar رضي الله عنهما, he narrates that Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, صلاة الجماعة تفضل صلاة الفرد بسبع وعشرين درجة. رواه البخاري. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that the prayer and congregation of a person is 27 times more superior than the prayer of a person by themselves. So not only is it commanded for us to pray in the masjid for the men, not only is it deserving, does Allah deserve that we worship Him in the masajid because He commanded us with that, but Allah then increases our reward and He increases the superiority of what we do so that He can reward us yawm al-qiyamah. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَعَسَى أُولَٰئِكَ أَنْ يَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُهْتَدِينَ. Allah, He said, the masajid of Allah, they are maintained, they will be maintained only by those who believe in Allah and the last day, and they establish their prayers and they pay their zakah, and they fear none other than Allah. It is they who are expected to be upon true guidance. Allah is commanding that for the one who truly believes in Allah, he prays in the masajid. Truly believes in the last day, he prays in the masajid. Truly establishes the prayers and pays the zakah and fears none but Allah, his place of prayer should be in the masajid. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لو يعلم الناس ما في النداء والصف الأول ثم لم يجدوا إلا أن يستهموا عليه لأستهموا ولو يعلمون ما في التهجير لأستدقوا إليه ولو يعلمون ما في العتمة والصبح لأتوهما ولو حبوا. رواه البخاري. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if the people really knew and understood and comprehended the value and the reward of pronouncing the adhan and standing in the first row in congregational prayer and found no other way to get it, to get to it except by drawing lots, then they would draw lots. And if they had knew the reward of zuhr prayer in its early stated time, they would race to it and go early to it. And if they knew the reward of isha and fajr prayers in jama'ah in the masjid, they would come even if they had to crawl. We would crawl for food, we would crawl for money, we would crawl for entertainment and whatever else it takes. But these salawat al-khams, the five daily prayers, which we are commanded to pray in the masajid, it's not something we crawl to. We look for every excuse and the other to not come to it. But we'll find every excuse to go and do something that will suffice us in this dunya. And this is the true reality. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لقد هممت أن آمر فتياني فتيتي عفوا أن يجمعوا حزم الحطب، ثم آمر بالصلاة فتقام، ثم أحرك على أقوام لا يشهدون الصلاة. رواه الترمذي وهذا حديث صحيح. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, I had every inclination to send out some boys to go and collect wood, wood that could be burned, and then have the salah called for the iqama, with the iqama for the prayer to be established, then to go to the homes of the men who stayed in the homes to pray when they had no valid excuse and burn the homes down. And if it wasn't for the women and the children in those homes, then maybe the Prophet ﷺ would have done so to prove it. So all these hadith, these ayat that remind us, that show us the importance of the salah in the masjid. And this is why, if we're really evaluating ourselves and reckoning ourselves before we're evaluated and reckoned by Allah, then we must ask ourselves, where are we praying our prayers? هل قرأت اليوم شيئا من كتاب الله؟ Have you read anything or recited anything today from the book of Allah? The book of Allah, the speech of Allah, His last message to all of mankind. The book in which there is guidance for everything, criterion for everything. The right and the wrong is found within it. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ This is the book in which there is no doubt. It is a guide, a guidance for the muttaqun, those who truly fear Allah and keep their duty to Allah and love Allah much and perform deeds to earn Allah's pleasure and distance themselves from Allah's punishment. عن أبي موسى رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تعاهد القرآن فوالذي نفسي بيده لهو أشد تفصيا من الإبل في عقلها رواه البخاري. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, commit yourself regularly, daily, a portion of time, even if it be small, to reading and reciting the Quran. For by him in whose hand is my soul, it is surely more prone to break away from you than a camel from its bind, from its reins. And this is very evident with the Quran. If it's not followed through, if it's not kept with, then it will escape from your heart and your minds. Because it is pure and it is good, and shaitan does not want purity or good for you, but Allah does. But what does stay in your mind 20, 30 years after you heard it or you memorize it is music, lyrics, songs. And this proves how that those things do indeed pull you away from Allah and His remembrance. عن أبي أمامة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم اقرأ القرآن فإنه يأتي يوم القيامة شفيعا لأصحابه. رواه مسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, read the Quran. Read the Quran. Because it will come as an intercessor for the its reciters on the day of resurrection. For the one who loves the Quran and recites the Quran, it will speak yawm al-qiyamah to beg Allah to forgive you and have mercy on you and admit you into Jannah. Who doesn't want that? But it won't come if it's just an abandoned book that's just visited in Ramadan and opened up in Ramadan and recited in Ramadan. So commit yourself to a portion daily. عن ملك بن أنس رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم تركت فيكم أمرين لن تضلوا ما تمسكتم بهما كتاب الله وسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, as long as you hold on to two things that I've left you with, you will never, ever, ever go astray. It is the book of Allah and the sunnah of His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. So ask yourself, have you recited anything, read anything, not in prayer, outside, read from the book of Allah, trying to understand its meaning and implemented it? هل تثابر على الأذكار والأوراد عقب كل صلاة? Have you persisted in the remembrances which are said after each prayer? And we constantly remind one another of it. But what? The minute prayer is ending, shaitan races to you. If he has it in your prayer already, he actually comes during the prayer time, ready telling you what you have to go and do, what you cannot forget, what needs to be done, what calls you need to make, who you need to go see, or whatever it may be. what sale you might be losing out on if you don't rush back. This is what shaitan does. So that the person, he rushes these adhkar, but those adhkar, if you sit or you pray, and you remember Allah without speaking to anybody, the malaika say, Allahumma khillahu, Allahumma arhamhu. May Allah forgive him, oh Allah have mercy on him. For you sitting in the place of your salah. Thawban, the free slave of Allah, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah, when he would end his prayer, he would seek forgiveness from Allah three times. Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. And then he would say, Allahumma anta as-salam wa minka as-salam tabarak ya dhal jalal wal ikram. Oh Allah, you are the one free of defect and perfection is from you. Blessed are you, O possessor of majesty and honor. This is also the response to the people of Jannah when Allah greets them with Assalamu alaikum. This same response, so you can remind yourself of that every prayer. عن أبي أمامة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من قرأ آية الكرسي دبر كل صلاة لم يمنعه دخول الجنة إلا أن يموت. This hadith, which is authentic in the Sunnah and Nisa'i, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever recites ayat al-kursi, this one ayah, that if you recite it decently, 20 to 25 seconds after every fard salah, then nothing prohibits you from entering Jannah except the fact that you're still living, that you haven't died yet. Is really what is outside of these doors, or outside in your home or your work, when you establish a prayer, is it really more important than Jannah? Because this is the equivalent of what we're trading off here. 20 to 25 seconds for you to recite أعظم آية القرآن, the greatest ayah in the Qur'an. Ayat al-Kursi. And it gets you this reward. Abdullah ibn Umar, he narrated that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, الصلوات الخمس يسبح أحدكم في دبر كل صلاة عشرة ويحمد عشرة ويكبر عشرة فهي خمسون ومائة في اللسان وألف وخمسمائة في الميزان وأنا رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعقدهن بيده. عبد الله بن عمر, in his hadith he narrated that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, there are two qualities that no Muslim person attains, but he will enter paradise. They're easy, but little people do them. So then he went on to mention, saying the five daily prayers after each one of them. Even if you're in a rush, because there's different ways the Prophet ﷺ did adhkar after the salawat. But in this narration we see, especially for the one who's in a rush, let's say, if after the five daily prayers, he says Subhanallah 10 times, Alhamdulillah 10 times, Allahu Akbar 10 times. This is 150 times with your tongue. But Allah will give you 1,500 hasanat on your scales of good deeds, Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the hadith he mentioned, I saw the Messenger of Allah وسلم, counting this with his hand. Doing the dhikr with his hand. So we should stick to the sunnah of Rasulullah wasallam. We all know the common way of 33, subhanAllah 33, alhamdulillah 33, Allahu Akbar 33, and then la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lahu, lahu al-mulku lahu al-hamdu wa ala kulli shay'in qadir, to the end of it. Or saying subhanAllah 33, alhamdulillah 33, Allahu Akbar 34. But there's a forgotten sunnah, and if we truly love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the sunnah that are forgotten, we should make it part of our day, part of our 2 or 3 days, part of our week, to do them one time so they're not lost. Zayd bin Thabit, he said, we were commanded to say after every prayer, Subhanallah 33, and Alhamdulillah 33, and Allahu Akbar 34 times. One of the Ansar, he had a vision in his sleep. And in his vision, in his dream, he was asked, has your Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded you to say Subhanallah and such a number of times with every prayer? When the Ansari replied to him in his sleep, the one who was visiting him in his dream, he said to him, فَاجْعَلُوهَا خَمْسًا وَعِشْرِينَ خَمْسًا وَعِشْرِينَ وَجَعَلُوا فِيهَا التَّهْلِيلِ فَلَمَّا أَصْبَحَ غَدَى عَلَى النَّبِيِّ صلى الله عليه وسلم فَأَخْبَرَهُ فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صلى الله عليه وسلم فَافْعِلُوا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, in this authentic hadith, or we will see that Zayd bin Thabit in his authentic hadith, to visit him when he heard what he was doing for the iftar after the prayers. He said to him, rather, say Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar 25 times. Add the tahleel, the la ilaha illallah into it, make them all 25 times, so they total 100. When Zayd, he woke up in the morning and he went to the Prophet ﷺ and he told him what he saw, the Prophet ﷺ said, do what you were told to do. So this is from the Sunan, from the ways of the Prophet ﷺ, the traditions of the Prophet ﷺ that we should implement in our deen. هل تحافظ على السنن الراتبة القبلية والبعدية? Have you upheld the voluntary prayers that come before and after the obligatory prayers? Question yourself with this. Because yes, all that's upon you is the fara'id, the five obligatory prayers. But what makes up for their shortcomings? What makes up for their defects? What makes up for not paying attention during to them? It's the sunan, it's the rawatib, it's the extra prayers that we do. عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من ثابر على 12 ركعة من السنة بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة 4 ركعات قبل الظهر وركعتين بعدها وركعتين بعد المغرب وركعتين بعد العشاء وركعتين قبل الفجر رواه الترمذي وهذا حديث حسن. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, whoever is regular with praying 12 rak'ahs of sunnah prayers. In some narrations it mentions 10. Whoever is regular with the rawatib, the 12 rak'ah prayers of sunnah, Allah will build a house for him or her in paradise. The 4 rak'ahs before dhuhr. In the one that mentions 10 total, it's 2 rak'ahs before dhuhr. The 2 rak'ahs after dhuhr, the 2 rak'ahs after maghrib, the 2 rak'ahs after isha, and the 2 before fajr. Whoever is consistent with these, Allah will build a house for him or her in paradise. We invest so much in the houses of this dunya. What about your house in the akhirah? This is the way we truly should be evaluating ourselves if we really want to hold ourselves to account. عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ركعة الفجر خير من الدنيا وما فيها. رواه النسائي وهذا حديث صحيح. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, the 2 rak'ah sunnah before fajr, in which the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم will read Surah Al-Kafirun and Surah Al-Ikhlas, short surah, those 2 rak'ahs before fajr, the sunnah rak'ahs before fajr, are better than this dunya and everything in it. They're better than this dunya and everything in it. Meaning for you to lose those 2 would be worse than you owning the whole world and losing the whole world. Owning all the land and losing all of that land. Having all the wealth of the world and losing all that, those 2 rak'ah, sunnah rak'ah of fajr. Do not miss out on them. And Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم رحم الله امرأ صلى قبل العصر 4. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he made a dua saying, oh Allah, have mercy upon the one who prays 4 rak'ahs of sunnah before asr. The majority of the people don't even know that Asr can have some sunnah before it. And this was a practice of the Prophet ﷺ and a dua he made for mercy to come upon the one who prays 4 rak'ahs of sunnah before Asr prayer. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, as Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu said, evaluate yourself before you're evaluated. Reckon yourself before you're reckoned by Allah. Because if you do so today, it'll make it easier for you when you're reckoned by Allah tomorrow. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم إن الله يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وبعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we gotta constantly question ourselves. There's a reason why these questions were put together by a sheikh at the end of a book just on your life, the life in the grave. We must question ourselves and hold ourselves to account so that we may make these changes while we're still living, able, willing, capable of making these things that will please Allah and distance us from His punishment. The next question he mentioned, هل كنت خاشعا اليوم في صلواتك متدبرا ما تقول? Were you in a state of humility in your prayer? Did you rush it thinking the whole time, okay, I'll go to the game, I'll go to this dinner, I'll go buy this from the supermarket and do this? Or were you focusing on Allah as if you see Him? And this is that high level of ihsan we always wish, we wish that we pray to Allah to reach. أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فهو يراك. That you worship Allah as if you see Him, but knowing that you do not see Him, He sees you. This is the level we need to try to get to. Were you in a state of humility in your prayer today and reflective upon what you were saying? Did you make your sujood properly without your forearm or your elbow or your wrist on the ground? With your nose and your forehead touching the ground firmly, making dua in your sujood instead of pecking like a bird or a woodpecker getting food off the ground? How did you pray your prayer? Were you in a state of khushu'? Allah, He gave the description of the believers who are successful. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Indeed, successful indeed are the believers. الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. The first description of them. He said, those who in their prayers, they have humility. Those who when they offer their salah, they do so with solemnity and full submissiveness, humbling themselves before Allah, focusing on Allah, on wanting to earn Jannah and being saved from the fire, worshipping Allah as if they see Him. Next question, to reflect daily upon هَلْ تَذَكَّرْتَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْقَبْرَ. Did you remember death and the grave? This is not cynicism. Because the Ummah has gotten very into just wanting to hear about Jannah and never about Jahannam. So wanting to hear about the good and not hearing about the bad. And this is not reality. Because we live in a world where this is not cynicism, this is reality. Death is a reality. The grave is a reality. Jannah is a reality. Jahannam is a reality. It's all reality. And so we must reflect upon these things. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul will taste death. And no one can run away from it or avert it. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أكثر ذكر هذا من لذات الموت. رواه ابن ماجه وهذا حديث حسن. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said frequently remember the destroyer of pleasures. Not that you're not allowed to have a good time, not that you should never smile or the likes of this, but because it's a reality and you should ground yourself. You should ground yourself, just like electricity needs a ground so it doesn't electrocute a person. You should ground yourself with remembering yourself that you will meet a fate that you can never escape, and that is death. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا فرغ أحدكم من التشهد الآخر فليتعوذ بالله من أربع من عذاب جهنم وعذاب القبر ومن فتنة المحيا والممات ومن شر فتنة المسيح الدجال. رواه أبو داود وهذا حديث صحيح. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said when one of you finishes the final tashahud in the prayer, in the final rak'ah, he should seek refuge in Allah from four things before his taslim. Seek refuge with Allah from the hellfire and the punishment of the grave. The punishment of the hellfire, the punishment of the grave, the trials of life and death, and the trials and the evil of al-Masih al-Dajjal, the Antichrist. هل تذكرت اليوم الآخر وأهواله وشدائده? Did you remember the last day, its terrors and its difficulties? A day كان مقداره يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة, the day which is 50,000 years long. The sun being overhead, the day of Yom al-Fazr al-Akbar, the day of the greatest terror. Have you remembered that day? That you will come on that day and a scale will be brought forth and your deeds will be weighed and every believer will have to cross a bridge over the hellfire. Do you remember that day? The day فَإِذَا جَاءَتِ الصَّاخَةِ, the day where the صَاخَة comes, the second blowing of the trumpet. يَوْمَ يَفِرُ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ, the day when a man will flee from his brother, وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ, his mother and his father, he will flee from them, وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ, and his spouse and his children, لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ, every man, every woman, every person that day will have enough to make them careless of others. Have you thought about that? Have you thought about the last day? It can occur at any time that Allah wants it. Signs are happening and unraveling as we speak. That it's coming closer and closer. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Buriftu ana wasa'a hakada." I've been sent in proximity to the last hour, to the last day, like this. And he held his two fingers together. And that was in his time. And we're 1445 Hijri years later. هل سألت الله ثلاثا أن يدخلك الجنة فإن من سأل الله أن يدخله الجنة قالت الجنة اللهم ادخله الجنة. Have you asked Allah in your day, every day, to enter you into Jannah three times? Because the one who does so, Jannah makes a dua for you, oh Allah, enter him or enter her into Jannah. Have you done so? اللهم ادخلني الجنة. اللهم ادخلني الجنة. اللهم ادخلني الجنة. 10 seconds. Begging Allah, Al-Firdaws al-A'la. And when you ask for Al-Firdaws, the highest of Jannah, where the roof is the throne of Ar-Rahman. هل استجرت الله من عذاب النار ثلاثا فإنه من فعل ذلك قالت النار اللهم أجره من النار. Did you ask Allah to save you from the punishment of the hellfire? To save you from the punishment of the hellfire. For so whosoever does it three times in their day, the hellfire will make a dua to Allah, oh Allah, save him or save her from the hellfire. And this hadith is in the Sahih of At-Tirmidhi, and Shaykh al-Albani, he authenticated it. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, there are more questions which we will continue to cover over the next weeks, to call ourselves to account, to reckon ourselves before we're reckoned by Allah. May Allah make us of those who take heed and question ourselves so we can better ourselves, getting closer to His mercy, and distancing ourselves from his punishment. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الاحياء منهم والاموات انك انت السميع القريب المجيب الدعوات يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم ادخلنا الجنه. اللهم ادخلنا الجنه. اللهم ادخلنا الجنه الفردوس الاعلى يا ارحم الراحمين. اللهم اجرنا من النار. اللهم اجرنا من النار. اللهم اجرنا من النار يا ارحم الراحمين. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وانصرنا على أعدائك وأعداء الدين. اللهم انصر إخواننا وأخواتنا في فلسطين. اللهم ثبت أقدامهم ونفس قلوبهم وارحم موتاهم واشف مرضاهم وتقبل شهداءهم يا أرحم الراحمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.